all-consuming topic of our digital response to COVID, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Ben Williamson. Ben is a Chancellor's Fellow at the Centre for Research in Digital Education and the Edinburgh Futures Institute at the University of Edinburgh. Ben has been researching new developments in digital technology and data in education for over 10 years. In his book, Big Data in Education, The Digital Future of Learning Policy and Practice, he detailed how data and analytics are changing the ways education policies are made and how teaching is managed. When he wrote his book, not even Ben, with his foresight and vision, could have imagined how relevant the content would be to the challenges in higher education in 2020. Today, in the fresh light of the COVID virus, he brings to you a presentation entitled Digital Data and Decision-Making in the Post-Pandemic University. Thank you very much, Ben.
Okay, thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here this morning. Just going to wait a moment for the slides to come up. Thank you. Okay, so digital data technologies are now at the center of many current controversies. So from Airbnb driving up over-tourism and property prices to Twitter currently taking measures to reduce misinformation in the US election, digital data technologies are not merely tools enabling people to do things, they change what we do. They change how we travel, socialize, communicate, consume, and maybe even how democratic societies function. Now, similar changes are already playing out in higher education. So for at least the last 10 years, educational technology and data use has been affecting teaching, learning, and decision-making in universities. But today, more so than ever, it seems. Now, the core point I want to get at today is that digital technologies and data can productively inform our decision-making at institutional, at faculty, at even individual levels. But that decision-making should also, I want to suggest, be informed by a sense of shared values and purposes of higher education. Now, I think this is an important point because digital data technologies may prioritize other values and other purposes and other interests, such as calculating the value of a degree as a return on investment, or making performance measurement the sort of the key indicator of teaching quality, or even treating higher education as a sector that's open for disruption for the purposes of commercial gain. So it's a fairly big picture, broad brush strokes talk today that I simply hope will provoke discussion throughout this event about the kinds of values and purposes that we want to support as we begin this sort of difficult process of sectoral recovery from the current crisis. Now, higher education has been the focus of a great deal of reimagining in recent years. So magazine articles such as these ones here tend to highlight a trend to envision higher education where institutions and textbooks and teaching practices are all in some way transformed. So various experts and different authorities speak of smart campuses, of unbundling, of outsourced universities, or the University 4.0 that's aligned to the fourth industrial revolution of advanced tech, artificial intelligence, and automation. So these imagined visions anticipate a kind of high-tech, digitally driven, data-intensive university in which as many functions as possible are delegated to or augmented by digital tech, and all processes, it seems, can be recorded and analyzed as data that then feeds back to inform decision making. And this decision maker in the University 4.0 may not even be entirely human. His visions seem to highlight how data analytics and dashboards can augment institutional decisions or make decisions on behalf of students, such as recommending course texts, or even make pedagogical decisions on behalf of staff, such as evaluating student performance and assessing assignments. And these new visionaries of higher education can be found everywhere, from international consultancies like these, or global organizations, the OECD, the World Economic Forum, to national sector agencies and government departments. So these McKinsey and Ernst Young reports, for example, I think are indicative of this high-tech vision. We've got this imagery of staff gazing through kind of data goggles to the university of tomorrow. They seem to be transfixed by the transformational analytics on the dashboard. And I think what these reports do, and others like it, is they kind of stabilize and fix a vision of the future of higher education. They aim to produce consensus and a kind of shared conviction that this data-led digital transformation is both desirable and attainable. And they provide actionable insights, it's claimed, into realizing these transformations in practice. But they're also full of their own assumptions about the value and the purpose of higher education. They include the alignment of the university to the data economy as a kind of producer of the technical talent required to boost innovation and productivity. A higher education in this vision seems to become centered on hyper-specialized careers development in the science, tech, engineering, and maths disciplines, and a kind of related downgrading of the arts, humanities, and social sciences. Now, of course, we need to be skeptical of these grand idealized claims. It's doubtful they'll be fully realized. But in some slightly more limited forms, they're already, I think, materializing in various policy proposals, governmental interventions, and various on-the-ground programs. So different reports produced by the likes of JISC, the Office for Students, the Higher Education Commission, KPMG, Universities UK, the Department for Education, have all in some respects pushed this data agenda into actual developments and uptake. So it seems to me there's a kind of emerging multi-sector consensus about the directions that higher education should take to satisfy digitally savvy students, we're told, by innovating the learning experience and to deliver economic renewal through innovation in teaching and learning. Now, these high-tech HE visions are perhaps materialized most spectacularly, though, in the rapid growth of the education technology industry and its financial sponsors. So the education market intelligence agency, HolonIQ, recently identified and categorized hundreds of education technology suppliers serving every conceivable task or activity of higher education, as you can see on the screen. And they estimated EdTech to be worth hundreds of billions of dollars. Now, my sense is that a market intel agency like this does two things. It attracts customer attention. It's something like a kind of online recommendation engine for what works in terms of higher education digital capability. And at the same time, it attracts venture capital and private equity in various products that can deliver a return on investment. So this kind of market intel agency, in a sense, makes education technology markets. It convinces customers that digital solutions will solve their problems, and it builds up the financial power of the industry that's then going to provide the technical solutions to those problems. with that investment, then I think we can understand educational technologies as a kind of programmed instantiation of this vision of a high-tech, digital, data-intensive higher education. So the imagined higher ed of University 4.0 or the smart campus or whatever seems to be kind of operationalized by being written in the computer code that powers the software that's then used by the organizations, by university organizations. So the learning management system Canvas, for example, was acquired this year by a private equity firm for $2 billion. And this followed its chief executive's claims last year that Canvas had the most extensive database on the student experience on the planet, which it said at the time it was planning to monetize with the development of predictive algorithms and study recommendations. The online learning company 2U here claims it provides an operating system for hybrid teaching and learning. So it's actively employing the language of computation and applying it to as a model for education. And there are also new product types that use different sources of data. So you've got Spotter and others that now offer student location monitoring through smartphone Bluetooth signals or Wi-Fi identification. We've got library system providers like Ex Libris, who've significantly expanded to granular analytics. So not just now supporting library managers, but providing services that can feed back data into course leaders' decisions about what texts to assign, or that might even anticipate and recommend what students should be reading next, a little like Amazon recommends. But based on the performance comparison of items that are included in lecturers' reading lists. So the computer programming that underpins these software products, as it were, kind of executes or operationalizes a particular vision of what higher education is or what it can or should be. And then those products get into the hands and the practices of university managers and educators and students, all with the aim, I think, of changing processes of teaching and learning to fit this kind of vision of a high-tech sector, and then affecting organizational behaviors and decision-making practices. So what we see so far, I think, is that this kind of vision of the smarter University 4.0 has been pursued into being by various different organizations and operationalized in institutions to a certain degree. But the problem, according to many promoters of this kind of envisioning, is that higher education has historically just been really slow to change and adapt and kind of keep pace with social and technical developments. That is, of course, until COVID-19 struck earlier this year. And in the educational emergency of mass campus closures that's followed, opportunities for kind of apparently long overdue transformation and revolution have been identified. And higher education has now kind of entered into what some people would describe as a historically unique experiment in ed tech. But a key question for me, as we encounter this kind of emergency ed tech moment, sort of ed tech experimentation, key question here is, so what values and purposes are we pursuing in such an experimental moment? Okay, so the kind of values of equality and of fairness and of access and of quality educational for all have all become key issues, particularly to address digital inequalities and ensure educational continuity for millions. But at the same time, these commitments have been coupled with more private and commercial interests, such as securing market share or competitive advantage and return on investment. So the question is whether these private interests support the public values and the ideals or the common goods of education. And do they do this by offering temporary relief from the catastrophe? Or are they more motivated to reconstruct higher education in a different form for the long term in ways that might reflect these private agendas? Now, I think the stakes here are high. A kind of long-term, commercially-led reconstruction around the visions and programmed templates of digital technologies could fundamentally alter how higher education operates. And I think it could raise significant, major, and perhaps even damaging disputes within the sector itself. The so-called global education industry of product providers and service providers and so on is already highly controversial to many researchers in my field, because it positions the private sector advantageously to deliver an increasing array of tasks in universities. It's privatization of higher education. And recently too, researchers have been documenting some of the specific issues emerging around digital surveillance during the pandemic, such as increasing governmental dependence on global technology companies or international consultancies for epidemiological and contact tracing. Now, I think higher education is kind of at the center of these two issues now. There's, on the one hand, the increasing privatization, and on the other, a kind of an increasing monitoring through data. So I just want to talk through some of these sort of emerging sort of pandemic trends. So one indication of the increasing privatization, for example, is the surge in education technology markets that we've observed. So large quantities of investment have been made over recent months, including some of the largest ever multi-billion dollar edtech investments. So this is both direct venture capital in companies, and also investments in new portfolio funds dedicated to digital transformation, like the one you can see here. So the wealth and asset management company Credit Suisse recently ran partner content in the FT on the potential of what it called the Netflix moment for education, as a way of seeking to attract investors to its edutainment equity fund. So these and a range of other emerging funds this year seem to reposition higher education as a kind of fast-moving market opportunity and as an edutainment sector with the disruptive potential of Netflix and other platforms. And one of the main market segments of interest in these portfolio funds is what's called consumer edtech, the selling of products and even streaming content to students as higher education begins to emulate the social media field. One of the other main market segments, of course, to grow here has been online degrees and online program management services offered by companies to host digital distance remote degrees. So Holon IQ, for example, again, calculated recently that the online degree market would be worth $74 billion in 2025. So online degrees are potentially lucrative for some. But these online program managers have been diversifying. So originally they were established to provide online graduate programs for distance international students. And they've now begun to shift to undergraduate programs too, understandably, as well as moving away from simply being online providers to offering or being kind of enablers of hybrid programs in partnership with institutions. Now, this model of kind of public-private partnership between these OPMs and institutions seems to reconfigure higher education as a kind of new hybrid between universities and private industry. It's of serious interest to investors, of course, as well as to companies and institutions. For the companies, these are often based on revenue sharing agreements where they often take around 50 to 60% of student fees, as well as management fees. And universities, of course, are seeking income from enrollments. The EdTech commentator Phil Hill recently described this as the creation of the instant global campus. Now, these kind of online program public-private partnerships, I think, anticipate a greater degree of what some people have called unbundling, the kind of unpacking of core university functions that can then be outsourced and delivered by private providers. So we could take Noodle, for example, here, which is a fairly new entrant in the field. It offers a full stack of services, so marketing and recruitment. It's a business model. It provides data flow between the student info system, the learning management system, and a range of third-party integrations. And it also provides learning design support for online and hybrid education as part of its promise to produce an agile campus for its partners. So Noodle's not just a kind of background provider, but it's in a way a kind of outsourced shadow campus that augments many of the tasks of its partners. Right down to the organization and development of taught courses. It offers, in a way, a kind of platform pedagogy, which then educators and students have to adapt to. Another key feature of this shift to online learning is how private providers have sought to configure HE in terms of job relevance. So massive open online courses, MOOCs, made their return this year for online education. Coursera, one of the big players, launched Coursera for Campus to extend the MOOC into formal degree programs, providing backup for students and staff that lack access to either classrooms or existing online learning facilities. But Coursera was also very much marketing itself in terms of job-relevant, credit-ready online education. And it included the offer of new industry credentials by partners, including Google, Amazon, IBM, that it seemed might even short-circuit the need for a formal higher education. So Google's own offer on Coursera was a six-month online credential that Google claimed would count as much as a four-year degree for posts in the company. Coursera even released reports detailing its own impact and its quality metrics. And it used to do this, and I quote here, 8 years of learner data and nearly 200 million course enrollments to provide actionable data-driven insights into how instructors and learners can optimize their digital learning experience. So Coursera is in many ways the kind of realization of this dream of the data-driven university in a way that wouldn't be possible on a campus location with, you know, just thousands of enrollments to study. So Coursera has 200 million historic enrollments to analyze, which gives it huge power to quantify and analyze what works, apparently, in digital teaching and learning. It's becoming a kind of cloud university in its own right that's constantly producing data outputs and then recycling those as data inputs that it can then use to improve, refine its product and better meet the needs of students seeking job relevant credentials. That at least is the promise. So Coursera indicates the truly global scale of many of the suppliers in HE today, and the data they extract and analyze requires significant back-end infrastructure for data storage and processing too. Coursera uses Amazon Web Services to handle half a petabyte of traffic each month and scale to deliver courses to millions of learners around the globe. The learning management systems Blackboard and Canvas are Amazon customers too. And in September, AWS announced a price discount scheme for universities to develop data lakes of very large volumes of heterogeneous information. And the process of architecting a data lake, as illustrated in the diagram here, involves tying together multiple AWS programs for storage, interoperability, management, analytics, and machine learning, together with institutions' own student information systems and their third-party learning management providers. Now, the long-term implications of this remain unclear, I think, but higher education does clearly now depend to some degree on AWS for back-end data services. And we might even say that the production of these kind of data lakes might condense into the formation of new forms of cloud campuses that exist in Amazon's giant data centers. These are cloud campuses that overshadow the physical spaces of the university, siphoning off from their data lakes and then performing some of the actions required to transform the institution itself into this new kind of university 4.0 format. Last point in this section before I get to some concluding thoughts. So, the result of these kind of developments is the possibility that being realized now of using artificial intelligence for so-called personalized education. And personalization is the kind of central imaginary of this university 4.0 vision. This is a university that runs constant analytics in real time to diagnose students' strengths and weaknesses, their progress, their problems, in order to then prescribe automated interventions or direct educators' attention. So one model of this is Buckingham University's proposed Education 4.0 Trailblazer degree, which will use AI to create personalized and adaptive course content tailored to each student's specific abilities and learning methods. Microsoft is offering similar promises, so is Coursera with recent upgrades for tailored study suggestions and personalized smart material. So this kind of university 4.0 vision may have been relatively long in the making and slow in the uptake, but it's now materializing at some speed. It's based on a kind of hybridization of the public role of universities and the private interests of tech providers. It promises institutional relief and recovery from the current crisis, while tying that to the enrollment of universities onto large-scale cloud infrastructures and even AI systems at truly huge scale. I think there's something beyond temporary short-term relief here, and a move more towards long-term transformation of higher education by the tech and data industry. So I just want to try and round up in the next few minutes before I go on for too long. So I don't necessarily want to critique these as negative developments. I think they actually demand much more careful empirical study. But they do, of course, raise many critical issues, and a variety of news of journalist articles have begun questioning the kind of ed tech mania and the use of surveillance technologies to spy on students through their digital course engagement traces. Even Teen Vogue magazine had a piece last week on student anxieties caused by online course surveillance. And in the wake of various scandals over the hires in Scotland and the A-levels exams this summer, the media, it seems, is already fixating on the as it were, the other algorithms that might be deciding students' futures. So if we turn over the sector to commercial companies, to AI, to data analytics, to the cloud, then we might expect this critical scrutiny to grow in intensity, I think. Now, a solution, perhaps, and a way of protecting ourselves and preserving what's truly good and special about higher education is perhaps modestly to open up a much richer discussion about the possibilities of the post-pandemic university by drawing on the sector's own research and expertise and our sense of shared values and purposes. So Paul Ashwin's book, Transforming Higher Education, a manifesto here, which just came out, helpfully returns us to questions about the values and purposes of HE. So he resists the kind of dominant framing of HE as an economic investment, and this kind of valuation of a degree in terms of preparing a future workforce. The purpose of a higher education, he argues, is bringing students into a transformational relationship with disciplinary and or professional knowledge. And the book asks readers to consider this transformational relationship with knowledge rather than the idea of transforming education into careers, skills, training as a central purpose of a higher education. And one of the others here, the Manifesto for Teaching Online by my colleagues at the Centre for Research and Digital Education in Edinburgh, questions what they call the impoverished techno-corporate futures for higher ed that are promoted by commercial and government ed tech. So they ask that we take into account the values and experiences of teachers and students instead. Now, the book's not against online teaching. It's a manifesto for it. And the book embraces the critical, creative, and innovative potential of online ed, driven by explicit teaching values and purposes, rather than being driven by commercial agendas or by data. So in these manifestos, digital data can still play a key part in digital decision making, but those decisions are importantly informed by truly educational purposes and by a recognition of the public value of a higher education to individual lives and to the wider society. I'm going to stop right now. Thank you very much, everybody, for listening, and I hope that provokes some discussion throughout the event and beyond as we look to our kind of post-pandemic future. Thanks again.
Well, Ben, thank you so very much for that thought-provoking presentation. Before we go into some questions, I'd just like to introduce the other members of the panel that are going to be answering questions together. So perhaps, Liz, would you like to introduce yourself first of all?
Very much so. Hello, everybody. My name is Liz Cleaver. I'm delighted to be here with you today from a very sunny south of England. I'm in High Wycombe at the moment, and I'm working at Buckinghamshire New University as the Pro Vice Chancellor, Education and Digital.
Thank you, Liz. And Matt?
Hello, everyone. Great to join you today. My name is Matt Curley. I'm the president of the National Union of Students in Scotland. And slightly less glamorous, I'm in Paisley.
Thank you very much, Matt. So I've got a question to kick us off, and then I'm going to be going to the Q&A and looking at the questions there. So you can escalate questions in Q&A by voting for them, or you can indeed add additional questions. But my question for Ben, first of all, is about the student voice. And to what extent do you think the technology companies and the data industry, round about the developments that you have shown in your presentation. To what extent do you think the student voice has been engaged, and do you think they ignore the student voice at their peril? And then I'm going to ask Ben, and I'm going to follow up with Matt.
It's a really interesting question, and many of these organisations would claim that they do engage with the student voice significantly. So there have been a number of surveys, one by Pearson Education, which they used to suggest that there's a kind of something very generationally distinct about contemporary students. They categorize them as kind of Gen Z or Gen Z. You know, this sort of this idea of digitally native, extremely switched on, savvy students, and then translated those survey findings into a set of kind of visions about how best to serve those students. So it became all about, you know, we know now that students want to learn in hybrid and online ways. I mean, this is a survey done before February, March this year. And so they use this kind of methodologically potentially quite partial and selective way of understanding student voice as a way then of building that into particular kind of technical proposals and business models. So we see then the rolling out of different subscription streaming models, where the promise is that these Gen Z students can access education in the same way that they would call up a Netflix movie, or, you know, that they can access playlists of learning content and so on. So I think there's something interesting going on here about the ways in which student voice is elicited and the ways in which those particular views are then sort of translated back into proposals for the very technologies that many of these companies have been pursuing for some time as part of their commercial strategies anyway. I suppose just the other point to add to that, and this has been a long-running question of mine, is around the extent to which student voice and allowing students to sort of speak for themselves is being displaced by an interest in data and allowing data to speak for itself on behalf of students. So this constant gathering of digital traces of students' engagement and participation and so on is kind of interpreted as a way of articulating the student voice at, you know, through big data at huge scale in ways that aren't possible with the traditional survey or the focus group and so on. But that raises, you know, huge questions about the ways in which those big data are then interpreted and cleaned up and analyzed and then used as a kind of proxy for embodied student voice itself.
Thank you very much, Ben. For me, this is a key question. So, Matt, do you have a comment?
Yeah, I thought Ben's answer there was really interesting. I think you touched on a key point about sometimes the data almost replaces our authentic voice. So a lot of the research that, you know, we've seen into Generation Z is, as Ben touched on, about you know, the need for more flexible learning arrangements, and often that's to be able to shape around the lives that students have to lead nowadays, having to work considerable hours alongside their studies. But I guess if you get to the crux of student voice, the data may tell you that students need a more flexible working arrangement, and that can be true. But, you know, should we not be questioning the hours that students have to work in part-time jobs in order to get by? Should we not be putting, you know, when we say we're supposed to be doing a full-time, you know, degree program, that education should actually be at the forefront and should be prioritized, as opposed to the, you know, the hours that students have to take on and Tesco and Asda and in the bars and restaurants to, you know, make up the living, the, you know, enough to get by. So I think Ben's touched on a really valuable point, that sometimes the data doesn't necessarily get into the full picture and allows us to have a a holistic discussion about what students are facing. And of course, I'm sure we'll probably have some more discussion around things like the National Student Survey as one of the biggest data collection exercises that our institutions do. And often, yeah, the, you know, when we've as students on a course, if you say there's this issue that needs resolved and it's done in good faith, you know, between humans to humans, that the data perhaps masks over it. And I'm not sure students are always aware of the consequences of the responses to some of these polls and you know, when they're asked for feedback and the kind of consequences that come with it. I think, you know, when you look at things like the NSS, I think there's elements to it where it's good, I think, that students are being asked their opinions on courses and how we can improve courses, but we're not necessarily aware of the consequences of that and the managerialism and the KPI targets and just, you know, the fact that our teachers are often spending more time on the, you know, trying to deliver on these targets than necessarily, you know, helping with the education.
Thank you very much for that. Liz, do you have anything to add to that question?
Do you know?
Well, Liz, you've just gone muted again.
Yes, sorry, my mute's playing up a little bit. Apologies for that. Now, I was really minded as people were talking about the conversations that have been going out throughout my career around, you know, the difficulties of balancing quantitative and qualitative analysis and what they offer. And some of the issues that have been ongoing, I mean, we talked about NSS, around how valuable it is and what it can offer and what it can't offer. And I think, you know, I just want to come back to some of the points that Ben was making as well in his talk here around the importance of context and the importance of social context and social learning. And one of the things I'm very mindful of, particularly as we're going through this very difficult time at the moment and speaking with our students and our student representatives, is that that context is really important. And actually, you know, I've got teenagers myself and I watch them all the time on social media and networking. But during lockdown and in this period, we're just moving into a period of 4 weeks where they're not going to be able to see their friends in Wales because we live on the Welsh border. They're really worried about that lack of social contact and that lack of engagement. And we're seeing that in our student body as well. So I think it's this balance. You know, we can talk a lot about the importance of streaming, the importance of education on demand, the importance of meeting employers' needs, but the student need, the student voice has to be taken into account. And we're hearing all sorts of conversations around the need for that social context, that social learning. And I suppose I just want to finish off as well and remind us that often, you know, employers, they may speak the kind of the language of bite-sized learning, unbundled learning, but actually they had often a very traditional experience of university, which they often value. And some of the things that they associate with a valuable employee come from that traditional university experience. So we're balancing a lot of contradictions here, which and I'm sure my colleagues will relate to this. We're balancing a lot of contradictions, and it can be very difficult to know what the right next step is in a really complex world.
Thank you very much for that, Liz. So I think that actually segues really beautifully into the next question that's on the Q&A. So this is with a question about, and I'm going to come back to Liz straight away for this and because of her role in the university. With the move online as part of the pandemic, it seems as though it would be counterproductive to go back to 100% face-to-face. And it says, are MOOCs the inevitable in the future? And I guess we could expand that question to ask about sort of online distance learning programs per se. So is that the future for us, or are we going to go back to something of a norm, what we would call a normal university delivery?
So you want to come back to me? Sorry, Claire, was that? Yeah. I think I absolutely agree with a lot of the conversations that we've heard today and that have been going on in the media and beyond about the power that this forced change has had in changing some of our activities, our ways of working. And, you know, we'll all be aware of colleagues who perhaps hadn't used all the platforms, whether it's Blackboard Collaborate, whether it's Zoom, whether it's Teams, and have suddenly had to learn how to use those. I think the difficulty for me my background is educational development in my latter years in universities. And the difficulty I have with some of this is that we all know as we start to explore tech that we use it in ways that we find easy. And we explore it in intuitive ways. And we often don't understand its power and its pedagogical potential. So I think the challenge for universities is to keep that momentum going, but to make sure that we don't just simply use things in ways we think are right or suit us, but are pedagogically correct and are really helpful for engaging students in all of those. I mean, been talking about all those social learning experiences in meaningful ways. And one of the principles I've been talking about a lot in my own institution, and just to say, I started in the middle of the pandemic. So I started my own institution in June. So I picked up as everybody had been working in the online pivot the remote pivot for a short while. One of the things I've been talking about is the fact that we should be making decisions as much as we can pedagogically, not just about ease or access. It's got to be what is pedagogically sound. And as we're starting to think about if we were to move to sort of the next phase, if that was to happen where we had to move more online, one of the principles we've been working on is what is going to be pedagogically sound to take online and what is going to be pedagogically sound to keep face to face if we can move into that halfway house beyond where we are now. So these are the questions that constantly I'm working with in my role at the moment.
Thank you for those. That is, I think that's very true. I think as priorities are shifting in the light of the status of the pandemic, we're all asking ourselves these questions. So what is priority? What do we absolutely have to deliver in person? And what would we prefer to deliver online? And what could adequately be delivered online and still maintain the learning experience? And those judgments are being made all the time at the moment as we move. Ben, do you have anything to add to this? Are we going to go back to a normal situation?
No, I suspect not. And it may not be even desirable to imagine we could. And to be honest, you know, online learning has a long history. I mean, people have been doing this for a long time. In the centre that I work in Edinburgh, my colleagues set up an online master's program in, I think it was 2006, long before I got there. But the way they organized that program and it's articulated in the book I shared on the last slide is very much values led, very much informed by consulting with students each year on their experience of that program. The program was developed through a team of educators working together. It was based on their existing research into, you know, the sort of the pedagogic soundness of various forms of online learning, and specifically sought to kind of resist some of the pedagogic limitations that are built in to these. You know, to these well-marketed platforms. And I talked about this idea of a kind of platform pedagogy. I think we have to look at a lot of these platforms and understand, and many of them weren't built to deliver higher education degrees. They were maybe developed for much smaller scale corporate training programs or people who are, you know, doing some kind of work-based training in the evening individually. And that kind of long history of the development of these platforms then feeds into the various constraints and limitations as well as the affordances that they offer. So I would reiterate this idea of approaching online learning through a kind of, you know, a professional analysis or evaluation of what pedagogies they make available and how those might be positive and productive and in what ways they're limited, and then what other approaches that you can take.
And Matt, do you have any comments on this question?
Yeah, so I think we're obviously living through the wildest of times where we've had to, you know, adjust to online learning teaching. And I think in many cases, I think students have totally adapted to it and, you know, have found it, you know, very easy to access and quite enjoyable. But of course, there are students where they are struggling with access, and some of the statistics we've heard, particularly in colleges, actually, not exclusively universities, about students having to access their course exclusively through a smartphone, not necessarily having the space to engage in their learning, you know, not having a room where they can sit by themselves and engage in learning and teaching. But of course, access was a problem before as well, and we shouldn't forget that. So research we've done of 8,500 students in Glasgow in the West prior to the pandemic showed around a third of university and college students in the city had skipped a class because they couldn't afford the train or bus fare to get onto campus. But I do think there's a wider discussion around what are our universities for. And I think there's a wider learning that comes with in-person teaching and an in-person on-campus experience. And some of that is social learning. It's breaking down and building up your confidence, meeting new people. You know, I can speak, you know, as an 18-year-old student on the extracurricular side, getting involved in organising events for 200 people, you know, an experience of a young person organising events like that, getting in catering, publicly speaking in front of hundreds of people. And I think that is as much a part of the university experience as purely the learning and teaching. And I think it'd be a real shame to lose some of the extracurricular side of universities too.
Yeah, I agree with you, Matt. I think it's I think that's the bit that our students are really missing when we have online teaching. I think, and you know, we're doing a lot of work to try and reinforce and enable students to be able to still engage in those sorts of activities because they are so critical to university education. So the next question on the Q&A is about a bias in data collection. So I'm going to come to Ben for this first. So what about bias in data collection and use? And will these data reinforce stereotypes and lead to closing down of opportunities? So Ben, perhaps you'd be a good person to ask this to start with.
Yes, so I mean, maybe the kind of the exemplar of how those issues have played out over recent months is the series of controversies that have emerged over distance exam invigilation or proctoring, where your screen can be controlled, your webcam's controlled, the audio can be monitored and so on. And you know, these become kind of 360 degree kind of surveillance systems to ensure that students aren't cheating, which I think starts from a sort of profound sense of distrust of students, which I find deeply problematic in the same way that some of the plagiarism tools do. But, you know, there have been a number of reports now that those particular proctoring tools reinforce a range of existing biases, that they reinforce discrimination. They can't detect faces of a particular shade, which results into flagging them with a particular kind of suspicion score and so on. So I think we have these kind of, you know, profound problems with the ways in which technologies that are based on this kind of collection of variety of data might discriminate. Particular students who, you know, the issues around neurodiversity, whose eyes move around significantly, might also be flagged. Students who live in poorer households, perhaps, where there are a lot of family in the background, might add audio, which then flags them as suspicious, which all leads to, you know, particular forms of, you know, potential intervention or in interrogation. And I think, you know, one of the other things is that we have to bear in mind, and, you know, an awful lot of these data systems depend on the collection and compilation of vast historical data sets. And if you as an individual student are then sort of compared with a particular kind of historical cluster, that can just lead to sort of, you know, the reinforcement of old potential, you know, historic biases that are contained in that data, in that data too. So, I mean, I think there's a huge empirical gap in our understanding of how this is actually working out. And that's a big issue here. You know, there's been a kind of outpouring of work, particularly sort of critical data studies work in the States on race, bias, discrimination in technical systems outside of education, but we have much less understanding of how those forms of bias and discrimination are actually playing out and with what specific effects for what particular groups of students in the educational context. And until we've done those analyses, I don't think we'll have a really proper, clear, grounded empirical understanding of the extent of those kinds of problems. But I think there are indicators that those might be there. And perhaps one indicator is, you know, the use of historical data in the highers and the A levels as a basis for then awarding exam grades or for moderating those exam grades. And we've seen exactly, you know, where those kinds of statistical models based on past data lead to. And it's really ugly and it's really damaging for the students involved and for the institutions involved too.
So Liz, maybe I could come to you. I mean, to what extent do you worry about a bias in data collection and when making the decisions you need to make about the management of higher education going forward?
I absolutely agree with everything that's been said so far. And, that, you know, there are, again, issues. And I come back to my point that I made earlier about the issues there have always been between the quantitative and the qualitative. And my background is in the more qualitative data collection. So perhaps I'm biased in my own way. But, you know, one of the things that I've always been a proponent of is the mixed method approach. So let's talk about that. And you know, you can apply that to analytics as well. They provide one side of the story. They provide one set of evidence, one empirical piece, which can be used to help you to make decisions. But you've always got to have that grounded with a set of other ways of thinking, other pieces of evidence, just to sense check and just to make sure that things are going in the right direction. We also have, you know, an element of, this isn't a kind of a technical word, but an element of intuition, don't we? Of kind of understanding of our students and of the sector. We understand where we sit, what our institution is, our values. We come back to the notion of values, the things that we hold dear to ourselves, the things that are important. And a session that's later on, I'll do a quick plug for a session that we're running later on in the conference on the intangibles project that I've been working on with a couple of colleagues in the Scottish sector, which is looking at the things that we can't necessarily measure, but we know are really important. They form the heartbeat of what we offer. They form the things that matter most to us and to our students. So for me, it's about that balance. It's about understanding the affordances of the data, understanding what we think we know it offers. And again, I come back to Ben's point that we're not sure quite what it offers us yet, because there is a bit of an empirical gap there. And then helping to fill some of those gaps with other forms of data, other forms of evidence, other forms of ways of knowing that we have at our disposal. And just keeping talking to each other, really important, and keeping those lines of communication open.
Thank you very much, Liz. Matt, do you have anything to add to the discussion on bias in data collection?
Yeah, so I think I believe you've seen some research on, again, coming back to the likes of the NSS, where you saw women academics being marked harsher by students, black and minority academics being marked harsher by students. And again, the kind of unconscious bias that's coming out in that data collection. And I think, there's clearly a really important role for data, but I think, as Liz says, I think it needs to be matched with, analysis and a human interpretation. I'd give an example about, if we're talking about the kind of the increasing surveillance of students. You know, we heard an example last week where some college students had lost their bursaries, and they'd lost their bursary because there'd been an automatic register being taken of whether they were accessing their learning and teaching. And it had turned out that the institution hadn't managed to get out the laptops to students that didn't have laptops, and so they weren't able to access their teaching. But the data showed that they weren't showing up to their lectures, and therefore didn't qualify for their bursary. And I think sometimes when you have just cold data, showing that a student isn't showing up or these kind of things, that you need that human eye on it to investigate the problems. It can be useful, in a case like that. That's where, we should be looking at. If students aren't showing up to a class, is there an issue there? Do we need to support the student? Let's reach out, see if they're struggling. But sometimes that doesn't take place. And it's making sure that data is used effectively, not just to punish students, but to support them.
Thank you very much, Matt. Perhaps now I could go to the next question in the Q&A, which is about the developments that we are very helpfully outlined are not necessarily all negative. And I think that's a really important point. There's been many positive developments. For example, more flexible ways of engaging with higher education can expand the kinds of students who can benefit. And I think we're all thinking about that. But what should higher education providers and especially academic staff look out for to protect what we value most about higher education? And perhaps, Matt, I could come to you first. What should our academics be protecting? What do we value most about our higher education?
So I think in this time, it is about the, I think some of the things that we need to think about the value of is the in-person teaching and delivery. I think this year, again, we're in a totally different situation where I think it's probably safer if we can deliver learning and teaching online, and where it can be done easily online. But I do think there are real valuable elements of the in-person teaching delivery that students are missing. Often I think the lecture comes in for a lot of criticism. The in-person lectures, the most old-fashioned, stiff, boring mode of delivery. But actually, my experience as a student is that that was often a really valuable time to listen and absorb information. And, in many cases, dare I say it, it was fun. Lecturers could see the audience's reaction, the student reaction, and would lean into anecdotal stories that would bring the learning alive. And you had the social experience among students in the classroom, in the lecture theatre, engaging with one another. And that is one of the things we're missing this year. So I think there's a lot to be learned this year. I do suspect that we'll never go back to totally what it was like before. And I'm not sure all of us want to spend 5 days commuting either. But I do think there's a lot of really valuable in-person stuff that we've missed this year, and students haven't had an opportunity to benefit from.
Thank you very much, Matt. Ben, how would you answer this question then?
In many ways, I just reiterate some of the things that other academics have been arguing over recent years in relation to, increased quantification and datification and so on. And that's about a kind of restatement of a kind of reevaluation and a restatement of what we really believe the kind of public and social goods offered by a higher education, beyond the kind of the immediate transferability of skills in labour markets and this kind of, you know, sort of, you know, really quite instrumentalist framing of higher education. And that kind of framing of higher education is very much reinforced and reproduced by systems of data collection, you know, because everything becomes a kind of performance. And the performance of a student becomes a proxy for the performance of a teacher, and that teacher's performance becomes a proxy for the overall kind of quality of the learning experience and so on. And so this kind of mashing together of different ways of assessing performance and then linking that to outcomes in terms of earnings and how much, you know, students pay in taxation, you know, 10 years down the line and so on. I think these are the kinds of things that, yeah, okay, maybe they're really interesting, useful numbers and so on, but when they become kind of drivers of what happens in universities, I think they're potentially really damaging. So, yeah, again, I'd sort of restate this kind of attention to, you know, what do we really think the purpose of a higher education is? And it's why I included these couple of books at the end, particularly this one by Paul Ashwin. It's only just come out because it's, you know, a kind of slightly polemical. It's like, you know, this has gone too far. We've forgotten to actually think about the genuine purposes and the values that underpin what we do. And it's a nice 120-page restatement of that. And I'd encourage people to go and read that as you know, one particular argument about what are the values and purposes we want to pursue. And his focus is particularly on what he describes as this kind of transformational relationship with either disciplinary or professional knowledge, which I think is a really nice way to start a detailed discussion about the purposes we want to pursue in this kind of rebuilding period that we're now going to have to go through.
Thank you, Ben. And Liz, your thoughts on the same question. So,
well, I just perhaps I'm not answering the question, but I just wanted to pick up on a point that Ben had made there around the fact that we don't want to lose sight of those things that matter most to us and we know are really important. And, you know, there's been a lot of discussion in the sector at large about our role in terms of employability, in terms of creating employable graduates. But a lot of, we come back to this notion of how useful the data is. A lot of the data or the evidence on which that is based on a very different system. And the lag in the data around this, you know, the assumption that people can have the graduate premium is based on a much smaller system, a more closed system. The notion that people had a privileged entry point into the market, the employment market, which actually we're moving into a system where we can't guarantee that for everybody. So how can we make those assumptions and therefore judge people? You know, coming back to this notion of kind of proxies and of measurements of proxies for worth and value. You know, we need to be really careful what we value, how we value, and also who does the valuing. And who makes the decisions about those values. And I think our role in higher education is to push back. It's not just to accept those values, whether it's from our respective governments or whether it's from employers. These are all important stakeholders. Of course they are. But it's also our role to be able to articulate the importance of our values, of our evidence, of our knowledge, of our professionalism, and how we can add to that and add value to that beyond a simple transactional relationship.
Thank you very much, Liz. I'm finding it very difficult to argue with any of you in the points that you're making today. It's really, really interesting conversation. So the next question on the Q&A is about, and there's a number of questions here. There are about three, perhaps we can roll them all into one. It's about the Coursera data, and perhaps Ben, I can come to you about this. And you know, it's about the context in which it's been gathered and how transferable it is, and indeed how ethical was the collection and the use of it. So, Ben, are you able to answer this?
I can't address the specific question of whether Coursera sought ethical stuff, but I mean, there are clearly significant issues with the idea that Coursera is claiming that, you know, it has sort of ultimate expertise in, you know, teaching and learning, despite the fact it has data on 200 million course enrollments. Those are, of course, themselves highly context-specific kind of cases. They might be huge scale, you know, that is a humongous data set. That's proper big data in education in a way you just couldn't gather, you know, even a national level. But, you know, just like using Twitter data to make claims about the composition of society, you can't claim that Coursera data gathered from 8 years of MOOC data could be kind of recontextualized to help explain other contexts. But of course, what Coursera is doing is, and like many other organizations in this kind of space, is it's using those huge data sets to make particular claims about what education is, can or should be. And it's claiming that, you know, if we want to develop job relevance and so on, that the evidence is in, that it should be done through this kind of platform. And that evidence is then supported by the fact that you've got Google and IBM and Amazon who are offering these accelerated short-term credentialing programs, which entirely short-circuit the idea of attending an in-person campus for 4 years. Because in 6 months, according to Google, you know, you can be trained up as a data analyst, and that will count as much as a four-year degree. So I think the context is completely different to the context of sort of, you know, the in-person or the hybrid campus and so on. But it points to very different ways of thinking about and seeking to kind of reconstruct higher education, or indeed build alternatives. And in some respects, although that's the kind of big tech platforms, it's also reflected in here in the UK, the emergence of a number of challenger universities that are much more kind of industry focused. They work in partnership with industrial partners and offer these accelerated degree programs. So the context is different, but I do think they're still leading to materially different kind of outcomes and changes in the sector.
So we're just a few minutes away from finishing. I would just like to ask a question now about perhaps of Matt and the student voice, because I'm always interested in the students and how they view things. To what extent do you think in the future we may have a pushback from students on ethical and privacy grounds about the types of data analytics and data gathering that are being introduced in higher education and maybe even accelerated in the future?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question. I think there is likely perhaps going to be a challenge in the future from students on this data collection, because I'm not sure we're fully aware of the data collection that goes on. Often you tick a lot of boxes when you start your course. You have a lot of forms, a lot of online forms thrown your way when you start your course, and you tick a lot of them. And sometimes, again, this data collection is used to try and provide support to students too, but they don't necessarily realise, you know, that if I tick a box that says, you know, I am a care experience student, or I'm a particular widening access demographic of student, that therefore the university might offer them support and get in contact with them, these kind of things. And we have seen in our experience students being taken aback because they didn't realise that, you know, that this was necessarily going to happen. But with the increase in use of data, I found Ben's presentation today really compelling, and I didn't appreciate the extent to which we're seeing data lakes. I've never heard the term data lake before. And I think, you know, once we begin to understand perhaps what's going on, there might be a bit of pushback. But again, as ever, I think there's helpful uses of data too. And I think there's a lot we can do to support students through collecting data.
Yeah, a really important balance for us to strike. So before we finish, Liz, would you like to have a final comment on the discussion we've had?
Thank you, Claire, for that privilege. So it's been really fascinating and really interesting also to hear other views, because at the moment we've all got our heads down focusing on the reality of life in our institutions, and it's a real privilege to come up and just take some air and hear other views and see other presentations. I think we just need to remind ourselves that we're doing well. We're working hard, we're doing well. We don't know what's going to happen in the next few months. We have no idea what Christmas will bring, but I know that we're all working really hard. We're using the evidence we have. We're listening to our students. We're listening to our staff. We're working together. And I think what will come out of this at the end, as we start to reflect back, is that actually evidence comes in many forms. Data is absolutely key to the performance of the university moving forward. It will become a really, really important tool for us, as it already is, but it will become an even more important tool for us as we move forward. But we won't lose sight of those human connections and our stakeholders in real time. And we will continue to have those meetings. And I think it's really important. I'm sorry, I don't want to take too much time, but can I just say, it's really interesting that my diary is still full of meetings with people. The fact that we left the campus, we are now back on again, but the fact that we left the campus didn't mean that I didn't have social contact. I had a different form of social contact. So I think, that's shown to us that those conversations, that communication, is still really key, and that the data forms the backdrop to that. It doesn't come before that.
Thank you very much, Liz. And Ben, your final word?
Maybe just returning very, very briefly to your question about whether we're likely to see student pushback. I think the risk of student pushback is incredibly real. When I think, as Matt's indicating, students encounter and begin to understand the extent to which they are being measured and assessed and performance managed and so on, it comes as a great surprise to them. I think it's almost inevitable that at some point some of the new kind of legal tech companies are going to get on to these kinds of issues and are going to begin poking around at, to what extent does this meet, all the kind of legal and the GDPR compliance requirements. I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't be using any of these technologies, but I think we really need to acknowledge that at some point a challenge is going to come, and it's probably going to be a legal one. And, in part, it's going to be animated by widespread set of concern about the way the tech industry has been, mining people's lives across a range of sectors in the last few years. That reckoning hasn't come for education yet, but I suspect it will at some point. And I suspect the scandal back in the summer around exam scores will have got particular organisations interested in, as I said earlier, what are the other algorithms that are, making decisions about students' lives.
Thank you very much. Well, what a fantastic discussion. And thank you so much, Ben, for your thought-provoking presentation. And to Matt and Liz for your contributions to what has been an incredibly interesting discussion.